here with Jen Kelly. Jen is a haute couture designer and
former dairyman,
just up the road from myself.
Northern Ireland, flying the flag of Ulster.
Yes. So, okay. Can you tell my followers a bit about your background? How a dairyman can suddenly be
a couture designer?
Right.
Well, probably I should go back to, you know, I started off as an Irish dancer in Derry. That's how we know each other, by the way. Then I did river dance. So
that
was really a break. Yeah, after college, maybe all the shows for river dance. And that took me really globally throughout the world, because every week it was a different city or a month.
Yeah,
and we were creating, like, there are 4,000 costumes in river dance, and 400 a week we were producing. So for one man to turn from just doing Eurovision to doing a show like that on the scale was just phenomenal. Now that lasted for me about 6 years, and then I wanted out. I didn't want to know anymore, yeah, I was so sick of it. But after that, then I was always a couture designer, so I wanted to really rekindle all of my clients.
Yeah.
And the one thing about couture is it's a one-to-one,
yeah.
So they do not want to see anybody else but me.
Mm-hmm.
So if your name's above the door, that's who they want to see. So I went back to my roots and bought a building there, and I produce only now in Dublin. And then what I do is take a collection then from Dublin to America or to Saudi Arabia. We've really kindled a fantastic business in the Middle East.
Great, I have a lot of followers from the Middle East.
Really?
So they'll be glad
really?
To hear that.
Well, the Saudi royal family is one of my clients, and
wow.
We would go to London. And I remember Kurt once she came to, you know, I got a phone call from her lady in waiting to, this is the Saudi royal family, and I thought it was Palawan, and I said, yeah, right, you know, so, but it was, and we've always, for the last 15 years really, worked, you know, more and more and more there. So
with such a huge celebrity clientele, how do you keep yourself grounded?
Oh, I'm very grounded. Anybody coming from Northern Ireland is very grounded. I mean, we grew up through all the troubles,
yeah.
And that is a very grounding experience for anybody. But then when I moved to Dublin, it's really like a second home, so I commute between there and here, and my family. I think family plays a huge part of my life, and it's the one thing that I return home to more and more. And every year since, you know, we were children, my family and me go on holiday together, and that's the one thing keeping me. Yeah, because like your brothers and sisters are not in fashion,
no.
So they're the one thing, well, I don't know about that, you know, and it's fantastic because you also get a life's experience. I mean, with fashion, it takes you to many places, and you get really privileged to be in many people's homes and hearts.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, at the end of the day, we're all one family,
yeah.
You know, so that's what's important.
And your couture gown, your base would have been full length.
Not really. Couture is really a craft, and
yeah.
The craft of bespoke clothing.
Mm-hmm.
So people that are rich enough can obviously buy clothing just for them.
Yeah.
So I've always carved out a market for bespoke clothing in Dublin, and now we work in London, and sometimes in America, but mainly in the Middle East. But really that is a privilege of making someone that is not as perfect as you, as perfect as you, because the garments are made for you. So we buy clothes from Chanel or from Dior or Saint Laurent, and then we make for the normal people with all the lumps and bumps. So they say, a suit for me, you lose 2 sizes. So we really don't work to that limitation that is in a store, because when we hide and disguise and make to proportion, we really don't lose the size. You know, so that's what's different, and that's the craft of it.
That's so important in today's society with all our different shapes and sizes.
Exactly. And also women of a certain age, you know, have a certain much more money to spend. So after we get through the 18s, we do the dance dress, then the wedding, and then they don't buy couture clothing because they make babies.
Yes.
Then after they make babies and their figures have changed a little, they come to me. And that's how we work. So when they need a little help after all that, that's when we step in again. So that would be my biggest market. So young from about 18 is the first dress, then maybe wedding, and then they stop, and then we help them again in mid-40s.
So have you got any advice for my followers who come from humble backgrounds who would love to follow a career in fashion?
Yeah, vintage.
Right.
Always start with vintage, because how you learn is just from the rag stores, really.
Okay.
I mean, vintage is huge, yeah.
Yeah.
And I've always worked in retail. So to learn the trade, you should really always, you know, begin from knowing your business or knowing your
garments.
Yeah, and you can do that very inexpensively from working from market stalls to whatever.
And even in a small setting such as
exactly.
Dairy or...
Yeah, you can pick up that bargain and you understand what it is. I mean, clothing really documents the history of any country or any period or any time. I mean, you've got the swinging 60s, the rock and roll of the 70s, you know, the crazy 80s and 90s, you know, to present day, which is recession.
Mm-hmm.
And even though we show hand-weeded gowns, we don't really sell that many of them.
Yeah.
Maybe for weddings or something. So all about now is about discreet clothing, you know, not clothing wearing designer Versace.
Yeah.
I don't think even if Versace was alive today, he would be as successful because nobody wants to know what you're wearing anymore.
Yeah.
It's all discreet.
A bit more subtle.
Subtle and discreet. That's the period we're in now.
Great. Well, thank you very much, and I'm
thank
sure
you.
My followers will do
pleasure.
Your collection.
Okay, keep
lovely up. To meet you.
Thank you.
Thank you.